All right. Well, thank you. Thank you very much for coming out on this cold evening. And we've had a lot of interesting little adventures and puzzles to kind of solve over the last little while. But we managed to get this gathering, and we have a very special evening planned. So thank you all for coming. My name's Michael Welch. I'm with CKUW Radio, one of the sponsors of this event. And we are here for a special evening with Vanessa Beeley on the Canada's Dirty War Against Syria, the White Helmets, and the Regime-Change-War Billionaires. So I think that maybe we should start this gathering. I just want to acknowledge that we are, of course, on Treaty 1. This is the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, the Cree, the Oji Cree, the Dakota, the Dene, and the homeland of the Red River Métis. We, by acknowledging the First Peoples, on whose land we live and work, we recognize their presence, past and present, and recognition and respect are keys to establishing healthy and reciprocal relations. And of course, these acknowledgements are just a first step in beginning to forge real, true relationships and to challenge these structures of colonialism and other oppressive systems. This topic that we're going to be discussing with our very special speaker is going to be delving into a territory that we don't often hear about, certainly not in mainstream media discourse. And of course, this individual who is going to be is joining us as our first time in Canada, if I'm not mistaken, is a major authority on the topic of Syria. She's been an on-the-ground reporter in Syria, as well as in Yemen, as well as in Gaza. And she is, of course, brought forth major insights into this group that we hear about called the White Helmets. You know, you've probably heard some things about how they're doing some amazing work helping out people in Syria. Well, there's another side to them, and it's actually serving a very different role, and that role and that narrative is undermining the foundation of a true humane policy abroad. So I'm going to, before I'm going to introduce our speaker in a moment, but I want to make sure that some ground rules are in order. First of all, in case you have to go to the washroom, you go down those stairs off to the left there and just around the corner, and so that we have washrooms present there. Also, we are going to have Vanessa speak for about an hour, and after which time there will be plenty of room for questions and answers. This event is co-sponsored, the lead sponsor of this event is Peace Alliance Winnipeg, but we also have the support of the Geopolitical Economy Research Group based at the University of Manitoba. We have the CKUW, and we also have the Hamilton Coalition to Stop the War. That's the major partner for the tour. So this is the last in a series of stops in which Vanessa has presented this subject, and she's going to be, she's had a lot of challenges, as I think some of you have already heard, in terms of dealing with people who don't particularly like this message. But it's important to point out that this is all about, this is an educational event, and there will be plenty of room for you to put your questions to you if you have a problem or if you need some clarification about the basis of some of her claims. She is more than willing to address them, just as long as we understand that we are to be conducting ourselves in a respectful way towards the speaker, towards each other, And I'm sure that we are all capable of addressing that. But if there's any disruptions, we will be cautioning you that that's not going to fly. And if that persists, then we'll ask you to leave. So with that out of the way, I would like to introduce Vanessa Beeley. Vanessa Beeley is an independent journalist and photographer who has worked extensively in the Middle East on the ground in Syria, Egypt, Iraq, and Palestine, while also covering the conflict in Yemen since 2015. And in 2017, Vanessa was a finalist for the prestigious Martha Gellhorn Prize for Journalism, which was won by the much acclaimed Robert Perry that year in 2018, the late Robert Perry. Vanessa was named one of the 238 most respected journalists in the UK by the British National Council for the Training of Journalists. In 2019, Vanessa was among recipients of the Serena Shim Award for uncompromising integrity in journalism. Vanessa contributes regularly to Mint Press News, Russia Today, UK column, The Last American Vagabond, Sputnik Radio, 21st Century Wire, and many other independent media outlets. And with that, I bring you Vanessa Beeley.
Good evening. Before I start the presentation this evening, I wanted to read to you something that a friend of mine wrote. She's Syrian, she's in Syria, and she wrote a Facebook post today. And I want to set the tone of this talk by reading what she wrote, because I found it so poignant and so touching. Because Western media has effectively ignored and disappeared the voices of the majority of the Syrian people inside Syria. So Rulan Nador on Facebook wrote this 7 hours ago. Do you know how many Syrian young men were martyred to liberate Syria from terrorism? Do you know how many children and women were raped by terrorists in Syria? Do you know how many innocent civilians were injured or martyred by terrorist rocket shells on their residential areas? Do you know how many Syrians lost their legs, their hand, or their eyes and became disabled during this war? Do you know how many Syrian mothers cried for losing her son in the army? Do you know how many Syrian dads felt pain to lose his son who was martyred to liberate Syria from terrorism? You do not know, because you will never hear about these in Western media, and you are not living inside Syria like me. I ask God to bring peace to my beloved Syria. A couple of other things, a couple of other points that I want to make also. This tour has been inundated with attempts to prevent me speaking, to deplatform me, to censor what I have to say. However, and that includes a number of academic institutions, but what I find extraordinary is that a couple of months ago, or a few months ago, the University of Toronto invited two white helmets to speak to students at its university. One of those was the head of the white helmets, Raed Sala. He didn't actually come to talk, but he was invited. Now, Raed Sala in April 2016 was deported from Dulles Airport in the United States for his extremist connections. That was admitted by the US State Department during a press briefing. Munir Mustafa, who was the white helmet who actually came to talk at the University of Toronto and spent an hour with the students there, has been photographed on a number of occasions alongside the militant groups holding weapons. I recommend everybody to look at Robert Stewart's work, where he investigates the BBC Panorama Saving Syria's Children program. You will find Munir Mustafa mentioned in that research. So it appears, just as it happened to me in France when I was invited by a parliamentarian to attend the screening of one of the White Helmet Oscar-nominated movies, Last Men in Aleppo, a huge row ensued within the halls of the Assemblée Nationale publicly, at which point myself and a French citizen were banned from the Assemblée Nationale. So in my opinion, we have a situation where Al-Qaeda affiliates are given a platform at our academic and our political institutions to present their case and to fundamentally brainwash our young people and to continue the propaganda that has sustained the war against Syria, while even concerned citizens of the same country where the White Helmets are coming are not given the opportunity to speak or to express their concerns. That's not the kind of society that I want to live in, particularly, and that's why, for me, it's so important to speak out about this fact, because in the UK right now, we have Julian Assange, who is incarcerated without any charge. The Swedish government has dropped charges against him, and my government in the UK is currently responsible for his ongoing incarceration and torture. So I can't express how important I feel it is that voices should be heard, voices that are challenging the dominant narrative, that are challenging the narratives that take us to war, and that is their only intention, is to service the military-industrial complex and to enable the global supremacists to continue plundering target nations. So tonight, what I want to do, as I'm in Canada, is to focus on the role of the Canadian government in supporting the regime change war that has been waged against Syria for almost 9 years now. It is this war that has led to the more than 500,000 deaths. Now, that is a figure that is always thrown around, that it's President Assad himself personally that's murdered 500,000 people. Logic dictates that if a country is at war, as Syria is, the majority of those deaths are going to be among the Syrian Arab Army, the army which is fighting hordes of international mercenary terrorist and extremist groups that have power multiplied the groups that were initially used and instrumentalized to destabilize Syria. So tonight I'm going to focus on three groups, or three organizations. First of all, Hala Systems. Hala Systems is an organization that was established by former US State Department officials that were also involved in the early fomentation of the uprising, or the alleged uprising, in Syria. Former US military, former US Navy, former US CIA, former MIT weapons experts. So this isn't the little startup company that it describes itself as. And Hala Systems, and I'll go into more detail about them later, Hala Systems collaborate with and partner the White Helmets. The Organization for the Prevention of Chemical Weapon Use, and of course, the White Helmets themselves. Here, I think this was their second bid or nomination for the Nobel Peace Prize. You will probably notice that all of the White Helmet insignia, all of the White Helmet marketing generally, is in English. The very simple reason for that is because this organization was not established in Syria. It was established in Turkey and in Jordan by a former British military intelligence operative, and I'll go into more detail about that later. Also, I've done a three-part investigation at Mint Press News with award-winning journalist Whitney Webb, which demonstrates the vast billionaire complex, governmental billionaire complex, that is running the PR industry for the White Helmets, providing them with marketing support, marketing initiatives, ensuring their protection and ensuring their promotion. And that includes, of course, Oscar-winning movies, it includes Academy Award-winning documentaries, and all of their marketing on social media, in the media themselves, at the think tanks, within governmental organizations. There's an extraordinary network running this organization. Of course, what this network works to cover up are the actual crimes of the White Helmets, or if you like, the violation of any kind of humanitarian organization under the Geneva Convention, under the rules of war. This image was taken from a White Helmet armed group mixed video. And in it, we see the White Helmets taking the bodies of Syrian Arab Army soldiers, having removed their boots, and standing on top of the bodies with a victory sign. Later in the video, we see another White Helmet video, operative, saying that they took the bodies of the Shabiha, which is a derogatory term for anybody considered to be loyal to the Syrian government, and dumping them in the trash like the dogs they are. That's not a neutral reaction from a supposedly neutral humanitarian NGO. And it is definitely not an NGO. It's not a non-governmental organization. It's funded by almost all of the countries that are a part of the US coalition that has been planning this regime change war since before 2003. What you see here is a British government document, draft document, talking about the funding that will be given to the implementing partner for the White Helmets. James Mazurier, the former British military intelligence officer who established the White Helmets in Turkey and Jordan in 2013, 1 year later went on to form Mayday Rescue, another NGO which is now based in the Netherlands, was originally based in Dubai, and acts as the recipient of the British Foreign Office funding for the White Helmets. It's the implementing partner and the manager of the White Helmets. And we can see here that 9 million were projected to be given to Mayday Rescue for the White Helmets between April 2017 and March 2020. We know that the British government has given more than 40 million to this organization since they were established. The American government, I think now around 35 million, sorry, and various other European countries have been financing the White Helmets. But what jumped out at me in this British government document was the fact that Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International, which have a history of providing the narratives to enable humanitarian intervention by members of the US coalition and effectively by NATO member states against target nations. These two organizations have stated that the Syria Civil Defense, and right now that's the last time I'm going to use that term for the White Helmets, they are not the Syria Civil Defense. There is an existing real Syria Civil Defense which was established in 1953 inside Syria, and it's the only recognized Syria civil defense by the International Civil Defense Organization in Geneva. Human Rights Watch and Amnesty International have stated that the White Helmets are their most routinely reliable source for reporting. Let's just consider that for 1 minute. Two organizations which have a history of providing the narratives that enable, that manufacture public consent for wars against Libya, against Afghanistan, against Iraq, and now against Syria, are relying upon another organization that is funded by the same governments and has the same agenda to destabilize Syria and to effect regime change or government change inside Syria, rely upon this organization for the evidence for their reports. The White Helmet has also provided very interesting wording here, essential corroboration that strikes, Russian-Syrian strikes, were not targeting ISIS or Daesh, but moderate opposition entities. And this has provided confidence to statements made by the UK. So in other words, the White Helmets are providing essential corroboration of the evidence that the UK Foreign Office and its allies in the US coalition need in order to continue their military adventurism in Syria by proxy or directly. What I'm going to do is to take you on a relatively short journey through some of the investigations that I made, some of the interviews that I made within Syria during my investigation into this organization. One of the criticisms always levied at me is that, well, you only go to the government-held areas. You are always accompanied by the Syrian army. Well, let me just explain. 85% of Syria now is back under the protection of the Syrian government. Any media outlet entering a country at war legally, i.e. through the correct processes, and going to front lines, are going to be accompanied by the Syrian army for their own protection and security. Even in liberated areas, the terrorists have a really nice habit of leaving behind booby traps. They'll booby trap things like washing machine doors so that civilians, when they come home and open the door of the washing machine, are killed. They will booby trap children's toys. They will booby trap virtually anything in an attempt to massacre civilians, even after they've been evacuated. There are sleeper cells in many of the areas that were occupied by terrorists. So I can bet your life that the BBC, The Guardian, Channel 4, all of the media entities going into Syria are, even if they won't say it publicly, very grateful to the Syrian army to be with them and to protect them and to give them security and to tell them where they should and shouldn't walk. At this point, in September 2018, I entered Dar al-Balad, to the south of Damascus. At this point, the city itself was going through negotiations with Russia for amnesty and reconciliation. The armed groups had agreed to give up their heavy weapons, but still had their light weapons, so they still had machine guns, pistols, etc. And at this point, we entered Dar al-Balad. What was the reason for my going there? In June 2017, a great number of Syrian Arab army soldiers were massacred at an airbase to the south of Dara. And images at that point, videos were circulated at that point of a White Helmet operative climbing over the bodies of the dead Syrian army soldiers while they were being dismembered by the armed groups, while the head of one of the soldiers was being paraded as a trophy. I will speak a little bit more about that in a minute. So my intention was to try to find out exactly what happened. How were those bodies transported? Where did they end up? Where were they buried? What happened to them? When I entered the White Helmet Center, and that was kind of a little bit by mistake, I didn't actually realize they were still operating in this area under the control of some of the armed groups. When we entered, what I found was interesting is we came in from the right-hand side and walked into what was basically looked like a schoolyard. On the left, we were told, and we were told this by actually one of the militant groups that was escorting us under the conditions of Amnesty and Reconciliation, the Shabab al-Sunnah, which had been part of the militant groups killing both civilians and army in the area. And they told me, yeah, that was al-Qaeda, that was a Nusra Front Center. And the White Helmet Center, as you can see, is very, very close. It's sharing the same complex. Now, that's a familiar pattern. Every area that I entered, whether it was Eastern Ghouta, East Aleppo, every white helmet building was either in the same complex or it was actually sharing the same building as Nusra Front or any one of the other dominant extremist groups in the area they occupied. What was really interesting also is the white helmets didn't recognize me, the ones that were running the center. But they were told I was a British journalist. Now, almost immediately, the leader of this white helmet group started to talk to me about funding. He basically said to me, okay, well, you know, we didn't get any funding from the British government for about 6 months. So, you know, we'd really like to talk to them. We'd really like to know why we're still doing our job. And he basically just went into what I can only describe as a kind of marketing performance of their role in Dada, and that he would very much like me to try and speak to the British government to turn the funding tap back on. And yet we're told that this is a Syrian organization. Entering the center, what I remarked upon almost immediately was the fact that the majority of the equipment was British made, including the fire engine that was parked outside, which you'll see in a minute, which I managed to trace it through the number plate back to the fire brigade organization in the UK. A number of these fire engines came in through the Jordanian border, which was also one of the borders for transporting weapons and equipment to the armed groups. This was the white helmet that was involved in the desecration of the bodies of Syrian Arab Army soldiers. Again, that's a total violation of any rules of war, particularly by a so-called humanitarian first responder organization. Many people might ask, well, did he just put a white helmet t-shirt on? Was he really with the white helmets? The white helmets put out a statement. They said, they didn't actually say that they condemned his actions, they just said it didn't quite meet with their standards, and that they sacked him. This is a common situation. We're accused all the time of the evidence against the white helmets being Russian disinformation, or any journalists that are associated with Russia are producing this disinformation against this group. The majority of the evidence against the white helmets comes from the white helmets themselves. It comes from their own selfies with terrorist groups. It comes from their own videos of them celebrating alongside terrorist groups dominated by Nusra Front. It comes from their own social media activity. It comes from the videos of the armed groups with whom they collaborate. The evidence is immense, and it's archived, and it's documented, and it certainly doesn't emanate in Russia. It also comes from the Syrian civilians themselves, who have accused the White Helmets of a huge number of crimes and atrocities. They have been filmed many times. In 2016, another White Helmet, Muaya Hassan, was filmed taking part in the execution and torture of two Syrian Arab Army prisoners of war. That video was released publicly, which was extremely distressing for the family. He was sacked. I don't show those images for some kind of sensationalism. I show them because they're only the tip of the iceberg of the suffering of the Syrian people that are living under the occupation of these extremist groups that are working alongside the White Helmets. One of the interesting conversations that I had with Al-Mahamid, the leader of the White Helmets, in between his pushing me to try and regenerate funding for the group from within the British government, was he told me that the white helmets that had been recently evacuated by Israel had among them a number of leaders of the armed groups in the area. They also had ISIS fighters that were fleeing the Yarmouk Basin that at that time, at the south of Damascus, was being liberated by the Syrian army. What he also told me, because I said to him, you know, you do have a reputation of being aligned with terrorist groups and sometimes of your own members actually being terrorists. And he basically agreed with me. He said, well, yeah, you know, if a group is Nusra Front or if the leader is Nusra Front and they run a white helmet center, this basically means that all his colleagues are also Nusra Front, but not in my area. This also bears out Syria is a culture which relies very much on wasta. And wasta is something where you can move up or you can be included in something you want to be included in through the contacts you know that are already within that group. So that actually concurs with what he's saying. If the leader is Nusra Front or the leader is Arar Sham or any one of the other militant groups, then it's very likely that almost all the members of the group will either be his relatives or friends of his relatives, but certainly they will adhere to the same ideology and very probably be members of the same group. In my investigation into Al-Mahamid and into the massacre, as I mentioned, at the airbase, we managed to trace how the bodies of the soldiers were brought back to very close to the White Helmet Center before they were dismembered. Eva Bartlett, who's also been to Dar al-Balad, spoke to civilians in very same area, and they told her that, yes, they knew that the White Helmets were dismembering the bodies, putting the body parts into plastic bags, and then throwing it on the rubbish dump. Al-Mahamid and this particular White Helmet group, I found a huge number of videos showing them wearing Free Syrian Army t-shirts, affiliating themselves very much with the Free Syrian Army elements. And actually, while I was at the center, Adam Al-Krad, who was a member of the engineering outfit of the Free Syrian Army of the so-called moderate rebels, he developed something called the Omar rocket, which I think from memory was a 500 kilo rocket, which was fired into civilian and military areas, military defending Dadaa, of course, against these terrorist groups. He turned up at the center, very much like the kind of mafia boss turning up to see what was going on. And actually, I had a very interesting conversation with him where he invited me to the protest that they were starting to revive on Friday afternoons inside Dadaa. And I have to say that in Dadaa now, there are almost weekly, if not more, assassinations carried out of anybody that is considered to be loyal to the government or actually belongs to the government. I think the former prime minister's son was killed a few weeks ago. He's a dentist. They shot him in his surgery. So these are not moderate groups. These are murdering, fanatic, sectarian groups. And if we go back to 2013, we have a very stark reminder of exactly who the moderates were even in 2013. Here you have Abdel Jabbar al-Qaidi, a Free Syrian Army colonel, speaking about their relationship with ISIS. I'm not going to play the whole video because it's quite long, but just the first part so you can get an idea.
كيف هي علاقتك مع دولة الإسلام
بالتأكيد تواصل شبه يومي أنا وأخوي في دولة العراق.
يقال بأن
بحال هذه الخلافات وحال هذه المشاكل الأمور فيها تهويل إعلامي كبير، فيها تسليط ضوء كبير جدا على موضوع دولة العراق والشام وبأنهم تكفيريين وحقيقة
هم ليسوا كذلك؟
قيادة القسم الأكبر منهم ليسوا كذلك، يوجد البعض منهم من العناصر ربما لديهم فكر خاطئ، ولكن عندما نجلس مع
أخطاء فردية إذن
ربما أخطاء فردية، ولكن عندما نجلس مع قياداتهم حقيقة لا يوجد لديهم هذا الفكر وتكون العلاقة.
So there you had the so-called moderates talking about their brotherhood with ISIS, and ISIS of course is the one reason that we use to intervene in Syria. It's the war on terror. And yet here we have the so-called moderate rebels that we've been sold for the last 9 years, in 2013, talking about their affiliation with ISIS. We've also seen a recent about turn by Western media, since they had to come face to face with the so-called moderate rebels that were transported from Idlib to the northeast of Syria by Turkey and used as proxies to invade the northeast to push back the Kurds from the border with Turkey and Syria. All of a sudden, we've seen a change in the media lexicon, and they're no longer calling them the moderates, having come face to face with their ideological brutality. So now I'm moving on a little bit. I'm going now to northern Hama, to the Syrian Christian towns that have very recently been liberated by the Syrian Arab Army. Or rather, they weren't liberated, sorry, the areas around them were liberated. These two towns were under siege for 9 years, and in fact, this year will be the first Christmas that they have without incoming mortars, rockets, Grad missiles from the areas occupied by the terrorist groups, dominated again by Nusra Front. Brett McGurk told us that Idlib is the biggest al-Qaeda haven since 9/11. This photograph I took, I think, towards the end of 2018. The area that you can see circled there is a city or a town called Kalat al-Madik, Madik Citadel. I was about 500 meters from the building that I've circled when I took this photograph. I was sitting in a restaurant in Skelbia. On that afternoon, from this town, were fired 16 rockets. One of them landed around 10 meters away from me. These rockets targeted only residential areas. They targeted the only hospital in Skelbia. They targeted the monastery, which acts as a community center, which is high up on the hill. They didn't target military installations. They targeted only residential and civilian areas. And that is another pattern. From all of the areas where these groups are embedded, they will fire mortars, Grad missiles, rockets, explosive bullets, send suicide cars, not into the military installations, not against the Syrian Arab Army, but against civilians. In Aleppo and Damascus, the death toll is more than 10,000. The number of permanently disabled children and civilians in Damascus, for example, is more than 30,000. Same in Aleppo. When I entered Kalat al-Madik, I found the White Helmet Center directly underneath the building that I circled in red in the other photograph. The building that I circled was the Nusra Front Center in Kalat al-Madik. There were no civilians in Kalat Madik. They'd all fled, and they'd fled to the government-held areas for safety. So basically, in an area which was occupied by armed groups, by Nusra Front, the White Helmets were operating alongside Nusra Front. There were no civilians for the White Helmets to rescue. There were only armed militants for them to rescue or to provide propaganda for. And it has to be noted that while the White Helmets claim, or rather the British government claims, and so does the US government and all governments that support them, they claim that they're there providing an invaluable service documenting war crimes. But I'll look into this a little bit later in the presentation. But for 8 years, the White Helmets were embedded, or maybe a little bit less, maybe for 5 years since their establishment there, they were embedded with Nusra Front in this area, and on an almost daily basis, Nusra Front was killing civilians and targeting civilians in the border towns. If you can find one document written by the White Helmets condemning those war crimes, I'll be very happy to see it. Now I'm moving on to East Aleppo. After liberation in December 2016 from the armed groups that had occupied East Aleppo, 25% of the whole of the city of Aleppo, for almost 5 years. During my time there, and when the White Helmets abandoned their centres and basically departed on the same buses as the armed groups, they didn't stay behind to ensure the safety of the civilians that they claimed they'd been taking care of for a few years. They left alongside the armed groups. When I was going through the centres, we found a huge number of documents left behind, despite the fact that they had tried to burn a number of the centres down, we presume to hide evidence. A large number of papers, boxes containing documents and files were burned, and we couldn't actually retrieve those. But some of the documents survived, among them a huge number of wage slips. So I know exactly what the White Helmets were being paid by name and by operative. And while they claimed to be a group of volunteers, even the most junior of White Helmets was receiving $150 per month, three times that of the salary of a Syrian Arab Army soldier who's fighting to defend his country against the terrorist groups that the White Helmets enable and sustain. Now, the circled guy in the center there is somebody called Abdul Aziz Maghribi. Maghribi was a member of the Al-Tawid Brigade, which invaded East Aleppo in 2012. Aleppo was traditionally loyal to the Syrian government. It had nothing to do with the uprising. It refused it entirely. So in 2012, they militarily invaded it, financed and supported by Turkey. Those same terrorist groups stripped the industrial areas of East Aleppo of their machine, of their machinery, of their factories, and transported them to Turkey. Industrial theft, basically, which was brought up at the UN by the Syrian permanent representative, Dr. Bashar Jafri, but of course has never been condemned. So Maghribi was one of the early militants, armed militants, that invaded this area. And of course that included or involved the ethnic cleansing of many of the civilians in that area, the murder of others, the taking of others as hostages to be used as pawns in their negotiations, etc. And at the same time, they invaded the real Syria Civil Defense Center in that area, killing many crew members, kidnapping others, and taking over both the center and the equipment. That testimony was given to me by one crew member that managed to escape at the time, but his family was still in East Aleppo under the control of the armed groups. So, going through the centers, we found some very interesting documents. Basically, contracts between two British consultancies, Adam Smith International and Integrity Global Consultancy, contracting a local council, a shadow state construct in East Aleppo. This was funded by the UK Foreign Office via their Conflict Stability and Security Fund, which is also used to fund the Free Syrian Police that was exposed by BBC Panorama as diverting funds to the terrorist groups, the White Helmets, Mayday Rescue, and every other organization that is involved in the demonization and the criminalization of the Syrian government. Maghribi was elected president of the local council in 2013, and at the same time he established the White Helmets. This is all documented. So basically, the British government was effectively financing terrorism in East Aleppo. Maghribi, at that point, when he was president of the local council and set up the White Helmets, he was a member of Nusra Front. He was also a member of Abu Amara. Abu Amara was another one of the most extremist gangs in East Aleppo, responsible for the protection of Nusra Front, of Al-Qaeda. So if we go back to Al-Mahamid's statement, if the leader is Nusra Front, then the rest of the group will be Nusra Front. The series of articles that I mentioned, which go into a huge amount of depth into the billionaire network that is providing the PR and protectionism for the White Helmets, part three of those articles concentrates on the Balkans as being the blueprint for the hybrid war strategy that we're seeing unfold, or we've seen unfold for the last 9 years in Syria. I'll just read now from a friend of mine's statement to that effect, Dr. Marcus Papadopoulos. I thoroughly recommend that you follow him on Facebook and his YouTube channel. He is a historian with an expertise in Serbia. He said to me, Yugoslavia and the Serbs were the first victims of the American-led unipolar world that emerged in 1991. Because it was in Yugoslavia, namely Slovenia, Croatia, Bosnia, and Kosovo, where the US and its principal ally, Britain, together with Germany, destroyed the sanctity of internationally recognized borders, disregarded the authority of the United Nations Security Council, dealt irrevocable damage to the United Nations Charter by having undermined legitimate state authorities and having supported, with arms, training, money, logistics, and intelligence information, armed secessionist movements which comprised fascist, Islamist, and organized crime groups, that's the Kosovo Liberation Army, facilitated the arrival of Mujahideen and jihadist fighters to the region, employed their respective media in the West to demonize the people standing in the way of their objectives, i.e. the Serbs, accusing them of mass murder and genocide, thus justifying the West's policy in the Balkans, and then directly intervened with military force to guarantee the accomplishment of their objectives. In short, Yugoslavia was the template for Iraq, Libya, and Syria. In that article, I argue that what James Le Mesurier did in Kosovo in 1999 was effectively the blueprint for Syria and the White Helmets. So we remember that this was a former British military intelligence founder of the White Helmets. In 1999, according to sources inside Serbia and according to Mesurier's own CV, he was working in Pristina while still with the British Army, and he was working under the directorship of this guy, Bernard Kouchner. Kouchner at that time was the UN representative in Kosovo. Why is this important? Because at the time that James Le Mesurier was basically working towards the transformation of the KLA, the Kosovo Liberation Army, which at that point comprised Al-Qaeda and Albanian warlords, and he was transforming them into the Kosovo Security Corps. So in other words, he was kind of flipping an Al-Qaeda outfit into something that was acceptable, giving them a veneer of respectability. At the same time, the KLA was conducting cross-border organ trafficking operations, kidnapping the majority Serbs, children, and taking them into Albania, where they were having their organs extracted and they were being killed, obviously, in the yellow houses. This was investigated by Carla Del Ponte, the war crimes prosecutor. She came up against a huge number of obstacles in her investigation, including from the UN. You might still be asking, why is this relevant to Syria and to the White Helmets? This is the only Russian element in my presentation. It's a seminal investigation carried out by Maxim Grigoriev from the Foundation of the Study of Democracy, and I thoroughly recommend reading it. The PDF is available for free on the internet. And over a period of time, I think over a period of about a year, he spent time inside Syria interviewing civilians, former White Helmets, even former armed group members who'd taken Amnesty and Reconciliation. Many of the Syrian civilians I interviewed accused the White Helmets of organ trafficking, running organ trafficking operations, transporting likely injured children to the Turkish border as they claimed for hospitalization. The bodies were then brought back with the organs removed and the child killed. People in East Aleppo were terrified to take their children anywhere near the White Helmets, according to testimony I received, because they felt that there were three hospitals inside East Aleppo that were used for the extraction of organs. So they would keep their children at home, even if they were more heavily injured. Part 4 of that book describes the organ harvesting, the stealing of valuables from Syrian civilians, and theft within the organizations. I've also written a very recent article about the death of James Lemessurier. More and more evidence is now coming to light, which is negating the theory that he committed suicide. Peter Ford, the former British ambassador to Syria, and I both agree that he was very probably embezzling money from the sponsorship that he was receiving from a large number of governments, as I've said, that were funding the White Helmets. And Peter Ford suspects there may well have been a UK Foreign Office investigation into his activities. The Dutch government withdrew funding from the White Helmets, I think, in September 2018, because when they independently monitored how the payments were being handled by Mayday Rescue, by James Lemessurier, they found that there was a huge degree of a lack of transparency. They also found that the system being used to transfer payments, Hawala systems, could very easily transfer funds to the terrorist groups. So the Dutch government was actually one of the only responsible governments in the fact that it withdrew funding from this group. Not so Chrystia Freeland and Canada. When the White Helmets were evacuated by Israel, and again, I draw everyone's attention to the fact that Israel was quite happy to work after negotiations with Erwin Kotler, they were perfectly happy to evacuate this group and various armed members. Now you might ask, why? Well, the IDF is very recently, or former IDF chief, has very recently admitted that not only were they providing medical treatment for the armed groups inside Syria, but they were also arming those groups. And certainly the fact that the White Helmets work alongside the armed groups and are comprised of the same armed groups, as I've demonstrated, then of course they would be protected by Israel. Canada has supported the White Helmets financially, $4.5 million in 2016. But Erwin Kotler, here described as a renowned international human rights lawyer, who of course is a Zionist sympathizer, his twin, as they're described in America, is Alan Dershowitz. Dershowitz was the defense lawyer for Epstein in 2008, reduced his sentence for pedophilia. Dershowitz has also argued for the reduction in the age of consent. He's also endorsed state-sanctioned torture. All of that is on record. Kotler, at this point, so just after the evacuation, was nominating the White Helmets for their third nomination for a Nobel Peace Prize. I'm glad to say it failed. What you will find almost all the time is when you question the White Helmets' record, when you point out the fact that they have been involved in executions, that they've mopped up after terrorist executions, that they've been filmed celebrating alongside some of the most brutal extremist gangs inside Syria. The scripted answer is always, yeah, but okay, so maybe they've cut a few heads off, maybe they've been involved in a little bit of torture, but they saved 115,000 civilians. I'm now going to demonstrate that that is not the case. We do have certain politicians and members of the House of Lords in the UK with integrity and with principles. And they have consistently been asking questions about this group. One of the questions asked in 2018, as I say, at the same time as they were being evacuated by Israel. And there is also, just I'll mention it, there is a Jordanian parliamentarian, Tarek Khoury, who very recently has raised questions in Parliament as to why there are still, as he describes them, white helmet terrorists on Jordanian soil, more than 100. And he wants them extradited to Syria to face justice there. So in this case, we're asking about the number of 115,000 lives saved. Basically, the information that is being touted around governmental institutions, by various state offices, by the media, by think tanks, by the UN, this information comes from the white helmets themselves, funded by those same governments. So there's no conflict of interest there. It's also supported by Mayday Rescue, which is funded by the same governments and is funding the white helmets. Mike King, who's an author and an academic, he sent me a file of the work he did going through 4,354 white helmet tweets. Now, why is that important? That's social media, is it important? Yes, it is, because actually the White Helmets website has very little information on them. The majority of the information feed from the White Helmets comes on Twitter and a little bit less on Facebook, but Twitter is their main information feed to the public. It's from the White Helmet pages that we get all of their rescue videos, all of the information of airstrikes, etc. So 4,354 tweets. Mike King went through them. They had actually only documented 625 rescues to the end of October 2019, of which only 88 are supported by plausible video evidence. And he did say to me, okay, I'm being generous with the 88. Of which only 9 are named, of which 3 have surnames. If you spend any time in the Middle East, you will know how insane this is. I asked the real Syria Civil Defense, that receives a fraction of the $35 million per year budget of the White Helmets, to provide me with the same information. They brought out, I don't know, like a volume of files that came to here, and they went through it. Every single victim, every single rescue is recorded, the date, the time of the incident, the name of the victim, the father's, the victim's father and the victim's mother's name and the family name and where they come from. So the White Helmets, which are receiving more than 200 million of our money, of public funds, are unable to provide documentation for their claims. It gets better. In the same 4,354 tweets, and bearing in mind that the White Helmets apparently document war crimes inside Syria, that is their greatest value to Human Rights Watch and to Amnesty International and to our government, of those 4,354 tweets, they condemned ISIS 18 times, Free Syrian Army 3 times, Nusra, Al-Qaeda, and Hayat Tahrir al-Sham once. Al-Qaeda, once. So they've committed no war crimes, according to, or maybe one, according to the White Helmets. Probably the most shocking for me is Jaish al-Islam. Zero. Yet Jaish al-Islam in Douma, in 2013, they were involved with Al-Qaeda in the Adra massacre, where Alawite civilians were burned alive in bread furnaces, and where thousands of other Alawite victims were kidnapped and taken to Douma, where they were kept in underground prisons that I visited after liberation, Tauba jail, where they were kept in solitary confinement, in cells this big, this wide. They were tortured. According to their own testimony, to the survivors' testimony, they were used for drug experiments. They were used for chemical weapon experiments. They were used, the children were used to dig the tunnels that gave the terrorist groups Jaish al-Islam protection. Many of those children died in those tunnels. They paraded Alawite civilians in 2015 inside cages as human shields. The mass torture of civilians in Douma by this group is well recorded, it is well documented, even by mainstream media, because it was impossible to ignore. And yet the White Helmets in 4,354 tweets did not mention one atrocity. Then let's look at a freedom of information request that was put into the British government. Basically, what the Foreign Office told us was the White Helmets provide no information or breakdown by province or area of those rescued. So, not very good monitoring of their claims. They do not, the Foreign Office does not visit Syria to inspect documentation or even to view White Helmet activities. They maintain channels of communication with a broad range of analysts, NGOs and media personnel, but in reality that just means Mayday Rescue, which is also funded by the British government. They claim that their implementing partner, which is Mayday Rescue, who they fund, contracts an independent monitor to verify whether goods and services are reaching intended beneficiaries and used for purpose intended. The British government is lying. Because the Dutch government did this investigation and they came up with the conclusion that they cannot control where those funds are going. They go to the terrorist groups, as shown by the BBC Panorama investigation into the Free Syrian Police, also funded by the British government. The Foreign Office meets regularly with Mayday Rescue and the White Helmets, but in Turkey at their annual general meeting. So in other words, there is absolutely no monitoring of the figures that the British government is giving us on the White Helmet rescues. And everything indicates that they have not rescued very many civilians. What I'm now also going to show you is a clip from a video, again, made by one of the terrorist group media outlets. In Idlib 2015, a huge number of White Helmet members, we've also seen them previously celebrating the massacre of civilians and Syrian army in Idlib when Nusra Front took over this city. But in this particular video, they're celebrating Fatah al-Sham, Jaish al-Fatah, Jaish al-Fatah, the Army of Conquest, which was an alliance of terrorist groups headed up by Nusra Front, which made up about 90% of the coalition. And in this little clip, the White Helmet is basically saying, long live Jaish al-Fatah. Sorry, that was a bit extreme. I'll say again, Idlib is the largest al-Qaeda haven since 9/11. And Sheikh Abdullah Mohaizani, who heads up Jaish al-Fatah, he's a Riyadh-educated and financed fanatic cleric responsible for the training of children as suicide bombers, amongst many other atrocities that he's overseen. To save a bit of time, I won't play this video, but in this compilation, you have Mohaizani Abu Jabba, who was the former leader of Hayat Tahrir al-Sham, praising the White Helmets as the Mujahideen of the civil defense, the soldiers of the revolution, recommending them and awarding them. Now, you might say that since 2017, maybe the White Helmets have seen the error of their ways and are no longer associated with the terrorist groups. Not so, because in August 2019, the leader of Hayat Tahrir al-Sham, which is a rebrand of al-Qaeda, Abu Muhammad al-Julani, praises his partners in the White Helmets. And I want you to just pay attention to something he says here about the early warning system.
كذلك كان هناك دور كبير جدا للدفاع المدني من فضل الله عز وجل لأنهم كانوا يعني يلاحقون الطائرات وعلى قائمة أهم الأهداف للطيران الاحتلال الروسي مواقعهم فيقصفون ثم تجدهم يذهبون يعني مسافة قريبة من موقعهم ثم يعودون إليه قبل أن ينقشع حتى غبار القذائف التي تنهال عليهم.
So, this is a leader of Al-Qaeda commending the White Helmets, so clearly there is a degree of collaboration between them. But he's also mentioning the fact that the White Helmets provide an early warning system of incoming airstrikes. So this isn't a civilian talking about the White Helmets providing them with an early warning system. This is the leader of Al-Qaeda And I come back to Hollow Systems. Hollow Systems is an early warning system that was developed in collaboration with the White Helmets, funded by the Canadian government, the British government, by USAID, which is a CIA outreach organization, and a number of other familiar organizations. So I can only conclude from that, and there is, I have actually done an investigation into Hollow Systems. I recommend you read it for a little bit more background information to this organization and the evidence that it's being used to basically protect the armed groups. And so my conclusion in that article is that the White Helmets are a militarized intelligence PSYOP agency working for NATO member states that of course fund them to criminalize the Syrian government and allies, and operating alongside terrorist groups also supported by those same belligerent nations led by the UK and the US. And I'll come back to the PSYOP operation in discussing the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapon Use. Canada is a primary supporter of the OPCW, and it's also one of the countries that's pushing very hard for the OPCW to be given the mandate to attribute blame in a chemical attack. It's proud to be a top donor to OPCW's work on Syria. And of course, when the alleged chemical attack in Douma happened, took place in March 2018, I was in Damascus at the time, Chrystia Freeland was out there, of course, immediately blaming the Syrian government, as was the majority of the media in the West and the governments in the West, which led to the unlawful aggression, the bombing of Syria, before the OPCW inspectorate had even managed to go there. And of course, where did the evidence for that alleged chemical attack come from the White Helmets? Now, Russia at the time was again criminalized and demonized for actually producing witnesses from among the medical staff in the hospital that received the alleged victims of the chemical attack, because all of them made a statement saying this was not a chemical attack, that victims coming in were suffering from smoke inhalation from an attack by the Syrian army as it approached liberation of Douma from Jaish al-Islam, the group I've described to you. Again, to save a little bit of time, but this interview with one of the young medical staff that I made shortly after the alleged chemical attack, he made exactly the same statements. He basically said the children particularly were brought in suffering from smoke inhalation. He said one of the kids was suffering from asthma and that was causing him particular distress. But he said basically the White Helmets broke into the hospital room screaming chemical weapon attack. And one of the slightly comical things he said to me was people that had come in and were lying on stretchers suffering from the smoke inhalation, when they thought they might get hosed down, they actually jumped up and ran out of the hospital. He also emphasized that the White Helmets and the armed groups, predominantly Jaish al-Islam, you couldn't differentiate between them, according to what he said. He said they worked together both on a financial level, sharing equipment, sharing buildings, etc. What was also quite interesting is when this attack happened, the day before, I had actually been in eastern Ghouta, in areas already liberated, with a number of mainstream media journalists, one of whom was Frederick Pletkin from CNN. We had visited a number of facilities that were under the control of the armed groups. And those facilities contained a huge number of toxic substances, from organophosphates to chlorine, to other chemical substances that I can't remember the name of, but they're all photographed, they're in my articles. When Pleitgen put out his report on the alleged chemical attack, he basically suggested that it was probably the Syrian government, but he didn't mention the chemical weapon storage units that we'd visited together. When I challenged him on this on Twitter as to why he hadn't mentioned those, he blocked me, and he actually put in a report to the Syrian media ministry that I was challenging him. In May of this year, the Working Group on Syria Propaganda and Media revealed the first leak from within the OPCW organization, which came from an engineer, Ian Henderson, who had gone into Douma and examined the report of the cylinders that were allegedly dropped from a Syrian helicopter. They managed to come through the roof, they managed to hit the floor, bounce off the floor, land on the bed without actually collapsing the bed or without knocking the ornaments off the shelving around the bed. Henderson basically concluded in his report that the most likely explanation for these cylinders was that they were placed there. Of course, his report was entirely omitted from the final report by the OPCW. This was the first leak which discredited the evidence presented by the White Helmets. Just as an aside, I took this from a former White Helmet promotional video made in 2017 in Khan al-Asl, which was actually an area where the terrorists themselves carried out a chemical attack against civilians and Syrian Arab Army in March 2013, which was reported to the UN. It took the UN inspectors 6 months to come to Damascus, and of course when they arrived in Damascus, the first thing that happened was an alleged chemical attack by the Syrian government in eastern Ghouta, which distracted from the fact that the terrorists had and were using chemical weapons. I myself was in Al-Skelbia earlier this year, I think it was March, when a number of civilians, around 30, were brought in from surrounding villages, having come under attack by Al-Qaeda, using what I can describe as toxic substances inside mortars. Those victims, including three children, came into the hospital showing skin lesions, damage to the cornea of the eye, respiratory problems. The terrorist groups had definitely used some kind of toxic substance in the mortars. And of course, in November last year, there was a similar attack in West Aleppo. And yet these are very rarely picked up on by any of the organizations like Amnesty International or Human Rights Watch or even the OPCW. In November, literally I think around 2 weeks ago, Peter Hitchens put out an article in the Mail Online. He had met with a scientist from within the original fact-finding mission who had written an email complaining that his initial reports or his initial findings had again been omitted from the OPCW report. And Hitchens concluded that the OPCW misrepresented the facts by leaving out key information, hid the fact that the traces of chlorine found on the site were merely tiny trace elements in parts per billion. When I went into the terrorist-held areas in eastern Ghouta, I found dozens, if not hundreds, of boxes of water purifying tablets supplied by the EU predominantly. Now, those alone would have been enough to provide parts per billion of chlorine. It contained major deviations from the original report, the OPCW report, submitted by impartial experts, so that it had morphed into something quite different. And it suppressed the information that the symptoms of the victims, demonstrated by the victims, did not add up to a chemical weapon attack. It was also discovered, and Professor David Miller is a member of the Syria Working Group, an academic based in the UK, that James Le Mesurier, so the former British military intelligence officer, had been meeting regularly with the leader of the OPCW Team Alpha from 2015 to 2017. And the purpose of the meetings was, amongst other things, to provide witnesses to alleged chemical weapon attacks, often from among the White Helmets. So the process of witness selection was contaminated by an operative, James Mazurier, paid by several of the belligerents, including Canada and, of course, the UK and the US, to provide witnesses to corroborate, I'll come back to that word again, evidence that would further criminalize and demonize the Syrian government and enable further military direct and indirect intervention against Syria. We have also recently been informed that OPCW inspectors have been intimidated. Of course, that's not the first time either. Jose Bustani, who was the leader of the OPCW in 2002, was kicked out by John Bolton under Bush because he wasn't corroborating the evidence of weapons of mass destruction. So what we effectively see here is the absolute collapse of the Duma chemical weapon attack narrative. We see the fact that the OPCW is clearly a corrupted organization that is being leaned upon by its sponsors, of which Canada is the primary one. And we see that it's basically being used to retrospectively justify the unlawful aggression of the UK, France, and the US. But it must also raise questions about all prior chemical weapon attacks and the narratives that have been provided yet again by the white helmets inside Syria or by their armed groups. All those, of course, who challenged the narrative of the Duma chemical attack were smeared, they were attacked. In one day, the Sunday Times produced four articles condemning myself and the academic working group as being conspiracy theorists paid by Assad, paid by Putin, paid by anybody, but just, you know, we were being incentivized into challenging their narrative, which could have taken us to war. The headline says it all. To say the Duma attack was staged is to enter an Orwellian world. No, the Orwellian world is that manufactured by Western media. And you'll see in this article the cropping of a photograph. In 2016, I met with President Assad with the US peace delegation that came to Syria to ascertain what was actually really happening on the ground there and to further peace. That was their initiative. But we are condemned for that initiative, as are many other people, such as Donald Lafleur, the union official who went on his own time to Syria this year to the union conference to find out for himself what is going on in Syria because he felt he was being lied to. And yet we are condemned for doing this. So the three questions that I want to raise here and now about the Duma chemical attack is if, as is increasingly being shown, this was a false flag event staged by the white helmets. Who killed the children and civilians who were used in that staging? Many of the testimonies that I took from Eastern Ghouta told me that the white helmets would regularly take their children and would use them for the staging of events. Some of the other testimony is horrific, and I will be writing it up, but certainly questions were raised over what the white helmets were doing throughout the occupation of Eastern Ghouta. I have written about one chemical weapon event that took place in Hamoulia, which was actually completely derailed by the civilians themselves. I'd recommend you reading that because it shows exactly how the civilians describe the white helmets taking bodies from hospitals or from previous attacks and using them in staged events. So my question is still, who killed the children and civilians that were used in the images and in the videos produced by the white helmets? Where are the bodies of the victims that Riyad Salah, the head of the white helmets with extremist connections, located for the OPCW, according to a Telegraph report at the time of the event? And just to see whether you're paying attention, why is this white helmet operative wearing a gas mask but no gloves? At this point, they were telling us sarin had been used. To give a little insight into some of the ridiculousness of the narratives put out by the white helmets, I'll play a part of an interview with Scott Ritter after the Khan Shehun alleged chemical attack in July 2017. Ritter, of course, is a former Iraq weapons inspector, and he's an urban search and rescue expert. Of course, the white helmets claim to be urban search and rescue, but I have a number of statements from former fire brigade employees, from former paramedics, telling me that the procedures they use would very likely kill the child that they're pulling out of the rubble when they pull it out, the child out by her hair, for example, and they don't stabilize the child. They run with the child to the ambulance, to the in front of the camera, without stabilizing her or checking her for spinal injuries or any other injuries. There's also an investigation by the Swedish Doctors of Human Rights into a previous alleged chemical attack in Samin in 2015. And the video of the children allegedly affected by those chemicals was shown in a closed session in the UN and allegedly reduced Samantha Power to tears. The Swedish doctors who watched that video said that the procedures carried out by the doctors, filmed by the White Helmets, would have killed the child if that child were not already dead. It's a very distressing video to watch. I don't recommend it, but I recommend reading the report from the Swedish Doctors for Human Rights.
Right off the bat, when you have samples taken by an interested party, in this case, the rebels on the ground, in particular an NGO known as the White Helmets, they took sampling without any protocol on the 4th of April. 9 days later, they turned these samples over to the OPCW, and the OPCW accepts these as viable sampling. Right off the bat, any finding that is derived from these samples is illegitimate in the eyes of the inspection business. So why the OPCW goes further and says, these samples show this, that's irrelevant. These samples aren't samples. They don't count as samples. They weren't taken by your team. Your team can't vouch for their veracity. Therefore, you shouldn't be talking about them. And that's the heart of my problem here, is that the OPCW violated every procedure it has in place that's supposed to guarantee its integrity as an organization, and in doing so, it's lost its integrity.
And as you point out, the White Helmets are not an uninterested party. They're funded by the United States government and other Western governments in the millions of dollars, so even that would certainly raise the conflict of interest suspicion, would it not?
Not just that. They peacefully coexist with al-Nusra, which is an al-Qaeda affiliate, and, you know, That automatically disqualifies them. But even more so, I asked the OPCW to explain. They used the term chemical sampling unit. They're supposedly a chemical sampling unit with the White Helmets. I looked at the videos. They're wearing training suits. Some of them actually wore, it's like they're playing Halloween dress up. They dressed up as if they were actual inspectors taking samples, but they're wearing training suits, which provide no protection. It's a joke what they did. Everything they did was theatrical. It was a visual designed to confuse or send a false signal to an unknowing audience. But to an expert like me, I was a hazardous materials specialist on a USAR team, urban search and rescue team here in New York. That was my job, is to do hazardous material sampling at the chemical weapons release site. What they did was a joke. It didn't even come close to meeting any standard quality control.
So they produce images to elicit a response, in other words, to manufacture consent for further military action against Syria. As Peter Hitchens said in a follow-up article, if bodies like the OPCW cannot be trusted, then World War III could one day be started by a falsehood. It's not as if it's the first time that we've seen such a falsehood. We've seen it in Libya, we've seen it in Afghanistan, we've seen it in Iraq on a couple of occasions. We're seeing it in Venezuela, we're seeing it in Bolivia. The list is endless. I'm going to just finish with a very, very short clip from a collaboration film that I made with a Syrian journalist, Rafiq Lutuf. It's called The Veto. It's available at my YouTube channel. It's available in, I think, about 10 different languages. And it basically documents the fabrications produced by Western media and Gulf-aligned media since the beginning of the conflict, leading up to the creation of the White Helmets. In my opinion, the White Helmets were created because the media was losing plausibility. It was losing the information war at around 2013, which is, again, in my opinion, is why the whole chemical weapon attack narrative began then. And the White Helmets were manufactured just before the first chemical weapon attack. Timing is always very important in these hybrid war campaigns, because they are never coincident. And basically, I believe, the white helmets provide plausible deniability for the media. So in other words, if something like the Duma chemical attack narrative starts to fall apart, the media can basically backpedal and say, well, yeah, but that was the information given us to, by the white helmets. So the white helmets take the rap and the media are not held accountable. So I'm just going to play this very short clip to you, which is just a very short trailer for the film. But I recommend watching it because it's very eye-opening. It shows exactly to what extent CNN fabricated news reports, Al Jazeera, Al Arabi, even a bit later on, but even at that time, Channel 4, CBC. the list is endless.
This is not the truth. I am afraid this is not the truth. You are reporting what somebody told you. This shouldn't be done on CNN.
I'm sure you all remember our Damon sniffing the backpack for chemicals in Italy.
Government forces and Shabiha.
Although both sides are saying that the other is responsible. So we have to ask ourselves, how much of what you've been told about Syria is true? How much of it is a fabrication?
If people decide to be free, independent, nobody can conquer that. Nobody can conquer that.
I think that's a very important message to end on. If everybody decides to be free and independent and to use their own judgment in any situation that has always potential to take us to war, precipitate world war, then we have to take a step back. We have to question the media that is fundamentally leading us to that war, and we have to actually try to judge a situation for ourselves and push back against this drive to war. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that, Vanessa. So it's about 8:30 now, and so I think we've still got plenty of time for questions, and we're going to allow for a, you know, give everybody a chance to put their questions to Vanessa. I wanted to mention a couple of things. First of all, there's a need to get some funds for Vanessa because, as contrary to what you may have heard, she has to finance her own trips. She isn't getting paid by any foreign governments, unlike some entities out there. So we're going to be passing around a couple of buckets, and if you would. We'd really welcome an opportunity, just take the opportunity to donate and give generously if you can. I'd also once again like to acknowledge the Winnipeg Chilean Association who've provided us this space, donated it actually, and it really came through for us. When you know some other venues backed away, so. You maybe want to say a good thank you and maybe applaud our hosts. I think if you wanted to support Vanessa on an ongoing basis, I believe you have a Patreon account, right? Mm-hmm. And something as little as $1 a month would be very helpful, but more would be even more helpful. So feel free to donate in that. I don't have that contact handy, but...
Right, then just look for Patreon,
Vanessa
Beeley.
Patreon? P-A-T-R-E-O-N.
Okay, so with that, we're going to have a question and answer period. If you have a question, you just put up your hand, and I'll give you a chance to ask your question. Try to keep your question. If you don't have a lot of time left, keep it fairly brief. If you have a comment, you can keep it brief as well, and then give Vanessa a chance to answer. Once you put your question out there, we'll give Vanessa a chance to answer Completely. Okay, so I saw this gentleman here had his hand closed.
I think today we can say that the Syrian government have been the victors of this war.
Yes. Well, not the Syrian government, not only the Syrian government, the Syrian people. Because I think what's important, an important point to make here is that, you know, with the reductionist arguments that were given by media in the West, of course, the only villain is President Assad himself. But the fact is, this isn't about one man. If President Assad were to step down tomorrow or to disappear tomorrow, the Syrian people would keep fighting for their right to determine their own future without foreign meddling, and also to defend their secular state. The last thing that the Syrian people, or the vast majority of them, want is to be ruled over by an Islamist regime, which of course is the preferred option for the US coalition, which would take Syria back to the Dark Ages as regards, and would also very possibly entail the ethnic cleansing, as we've seen throughout the 9-year war, of the minorities inside Syria.
I see this gentleman here has a question.
So, what are we supposed to do? And hopefully something other than voting, because I have a difficult time believing that voting for a Democrat or voting for the NDP is going to do anyone a whole lot of good in this situation. So what do we do?
I think, I mean, the one thing that I recommend is that considering the number of crimes that the White Helmets themselves have filmed themselves committing or have been filmed by the armed groups committing, and this is a publicly funded organization, so we have a right as concerned citizens to demand at least an independent inquiry into this organization. And I think that is what people should be pushing for. If Oxfam or Red Cross or Syrian Arab Red Crescent, if their members had committed the infractions of international law or of Geneva Convention that the White Helmets have, we would be asking for an investigation, and there would be an investigation, as we've seen sort of fairly recently with Red Cross and Oxfam. And yet, somehow, not only is there not a public inquiry, but any questioning of the White Helmets is met with censorship or demonization or smearing by the media and by all the entities that protect them. So I think it's very important to ask at least for a public inquiry. You're paying this organization. Thank you.
Okay, Damon?
So I saw the pictures you have of the things being staked, the bomb on the bed and everything. Why are they so sloppy? Why do you think they're so sloppy and how they do it? I mean, it doesn't take an expert to...
I think...
Do you repeat the question?
Yeah, sorry. He was basically asking, like, for example, the instant of the cylinder being placed on the bed. Why are they so sloppy? Why are they so careless in their production of staged events? I think there's maybe a number of elements. One, they know that they're protected. They know that whatever they produce, the media is going to run with it. They know probably, or certainly James and Missourian knew, that the OPCW would also protect the evidence and not present it as it was reported by the engineers and scientists that whose opinions and evidence was suppressed by the OPCW. And they know that fundamentally the West is behind them. So kind of whatever they produce, they'll be covered. But I think also in some cases, because particularly in Eastern Ghouta, they did, as I say, there was a chemical attack that was kind of derailed by civilians. I think it was less than a week before the Douma chemical attack. And I think they became a little bit panicky because the Syrian army was approaching. They were also in Douma under control of Jaish al-Islam. And what's really interesting with that relationship in particular is the British government was also funding PR for Jaish al-Islam. I've described how brutal this group was. And through another company called Incostrat, which was funded again by the Conflict Stability and Security Fund to produce media assistance and marketing for Jaish al-Islam, considered one of the moderate opposition groups. And there is a strong indication that the White Helmets, also funded by the British government, were tasked with the media promotion of Jaish al-Islam, or protection of Jaish al-Islam, with the videos they produced from within Duma. I mean, you only have to follow the funding chain to figure out the relationship between the White Helmets and Jaish al-Islam. So it could easily be that, you know, they were under pressure to produce this chemical attack, and therefore they made, I personally think they made mistakes in all of the chemical attack. But in this one, yeah, they were particularly sloppy.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, Brother Donald LeFleur from the Canadian Labour Congress made a principled statement when he was in Syria about the need for international solidarity between working people of all countries. He was punished for that. I've asked a few people if he was reinstated. The CLC had a few meetings recently, but I don't know if he was reinstated.
No, he's on our administration leave, and they've not given him any date that that will end, so he's basically still in limbo. There are various petitions, by the way, to support him.
Yeah.
It might be nice if you can, if you feel you want to support him, he would really be appreciative of that.
It might help to say a few words about the scope of the meeting, like what other countries were there, what other trade unions were represented, and so on. Were there any other trade unions from the West?
I believe so. I'd have to look into that a little bit. I know that there were representatives from the West there, yes, for certain. And I think a number of South American countries were represented. I can't give you the full list, but I can certainly find out for you. If you give me your email, I can send you all the details.
This gentleman over here.
I wanted to ask you, what do you think European has been the role of the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights? And have you seen any links with the White Helmets, whether they're like just a mouthpiece of the White Helmets, or if they're just like sending information? So they have any people on the ground in Syria who are the Syrian Observatory of Human Rights? Are there links with the White Helmets or not?
The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights is, how can I describe it? They're probably one of the better outlets. They do, they are a little bit more truthful, actually, than some of the UN reports and some of the media reports, occasionally. I'm not aware that they specifically rely upon White Helmet evidence, as does, of course, Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, British government, Canadian government, etc. I think they have some people on the ground, yeah. They're funded by the EU, I believe, Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, and of course it's one man in Coventry in the UK who receives information, I believe, by Skype or by telecommunication. I'm not too sure, and I'm pretty sure he protects his sources on the ground, but I'm not sure exactly who they are. But he's not the worst, to be honest. Yeah, they do use him. At the UN, I believe the UN stopped using him because very early on he was reporting casualties and not delineating between civilian and military, but armed group member casualties. Sorry.
We're going to get, I think, this gentleman over here has a question.
Quick questions. I'm sorry, it was the beginning, but.
It's okay.
What led to the change of venue?
Well, I guess I can answer that. That was a result of we had tried to originally book the University of Winnipeg, and we, you know, it was a little bit complicated, but essentially, ultimately what happened was that we were informed that we wouldn't be able to book this event there. And we weren't really given an explanation, except that they were concerned about the content. Then we managed to book another venue, and a few days later, we got a senior person, a senior manager, informing us that they reviewed the content and they indicated it didn't meet with their guidelines, but we otherwise don't really know what officially what the reasons were, though we have some suspicions that, in fact, some strong suspicions that there was a campaign to deplatform her from those venues, and we also have reason to believe that there was an attempt to deplatform her even from, deplatform her even, you know what I mean by the term deplatform, try to deny her a space at those venues and even this one. So
okay.
So there are some, she has some detractors
okay.
based on some things that she's been talking about.
Thank you. Secondly, what's the agenda of the West in funding groups like the White Helmets and doing what they're doing in that region? What are they trying to accomplish?
I think you have to look at the fact that the US coalition had obviously previously directly intervened in countries like Afghanistan, Libya, Iraq, and public opinion when American soldiers, for example, started to come back dead from those military operations, as in Iraq. The campaign against Syria was planned long before 2011. Just to give you a few examples, if you look at Professor Sachs, Timber Sycamore, the CIA operation against Syria, if you look at intelligence agency documents talking about the instrumentalization or the weaponization of the Muslim Brotherhood within Syria, if you go back to the Bush-Blair communications between 2001-2003, recorded in the Chilcot report looking into the weapons of mass destruction fabrication, you will find Bush and Blair discussing how to overthrow Saddam Hussein and how initially they might try to foster a different kind of relationship with President Assad to avoid having to military intervene via proxies. In 2009, Roland Dumas, or rather in 2013, Roland Dumas, the former foreign minister in France, reported that in 2009, Britain approached him to talk about the fomenting of an uprising in Syria and the arming and financing of the militant groups to do so. And I think what we're seeing in Syria is the first kind of manifestation of a real hybrid war, the use of proxies instead of their own military. And those proxies, of course, being groups like Nusra Front and ISIS, which we know were created previously. We know Hillary Clinton has admitted to that in Afghanistan. ISIS kind of morphed out of Al-Qaeda. There's no big difference between ISIS and Al-Qaeda. They are both proxies of the US coalition, as admitted by John Kerry in 2016. The only difference between them is the financing, whether it's Saudi Arabia or Qatar or Turkey. And I think groups like the White Helmets, of course, we know that the manufacturing of consent for these so-called humanitarian interventions, these responsibility to protect interventions, has to be manufactured, if not by the media, then by the think tanks, the influencing organizations, even the UN, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, etc. And the White Helmets, as I said, the blueprint largely comes from former Yugoslavia. And there we had James Lemessurier basically doing it the other way around, transforming Al-Qaeda into, if you like, a former kind of White Helmet. In Syria, we saw them create this first responder unit, which is very difficult to criticize since 9/11. You know, the first responders are this kind of untouchable image. Creating the White Helmets, embedding them with the terrorist groups to provide this kind of humanitarian cover for those terrorist groups. I mean, the White Helmets move always with the armed groups. They are exclusively embedded with the armed groups in areas, as I've proven, where often there are no civilians, only the terrorist groups. And so they provide the humanitarian pretext for the demonization and criminalization of the Syrian government. They provide protection for the proxy armed groups of the US coalition, which are being used to destabilize Syria and to topple, or in theory, that's what they were trying to do, to topple the Syrian government. So you're looking really at just another element of the whole kind of hybrid war network that has been used, I think, more extensively against Syria than any other country, probably because of the level of resistance from within Syria to such a project.
Why do they want to topple the Syrian government? That's where I'm not... That's okay.
That's a pretty long answer. If you look at the geographic location of Syria, I mean, it's the hub of the wheel. It's the connection to Iran, to Russia, to China. President Assad, as I said, prior to 2009, was being courted by the West. Tony Blair in 2002 offered or wanted him to have an honorary knighthood. So they were trying to, if you like, bring Assad into lockstep with their policy in the region and, of course, protecting Israel. What Assad refused to do was to abandon the Palestinian cause. He refused to abandon Hezbollah. He refused to abandon Iran. And he favored the Russian-backed Iranian pipeline project over the US-backed Qatari pipeline project. And that was around 2009. And around 2009 was when we know that Britain and the US started to build up the support for the militant organizations. Syria was negotiating with China for the Five Seas project. So Syria would become the trade hub of the old China Silk Route. So it would become a very important trade partner for China, for Russia in the region, and also potentially with Europe. So it was challenging directly US supremacy in the region. And again, of course, I come back to it was also challenging Israel. And so it became very apparent that Assad was not going to come into line and be compliant with US and Israeli hegemony in the region. So therefore, he had to go. That's a very simplified version. It's a lot more complex than that, but that's basically what it comes down to. And also, the reason, one of the reasons why Russia has come into this conflict, one, it had a long-standing arrangement with Syria to have its naval base and military base in Tartus for the last 50-plus years. But also, for China, Russia, and Iran, if they can contain the terrorist threat within Syria and beat it within Syria, then they protect their own borders, because you have to understand that the Uyghurs from China are fighting in Syria as mercenaries. The Chechens are fighting. And there are various extremist elements that would return to Iran. So for all these countries, it's very important for them to defeat this terrorist threat inside Syria. It's also very important for us. I mean, Syria is providing, you know, a huge service for humanity, because those terrorists being defeated inside Syria comprise American, Canadian, European, English terrorists.
Thank you.
How are you doing? You've been on your feet for almost 2 hours. So.
Nah, I'm fine. If there's one more question, I don't mind taking it.
Yeah, I see a couple of people haven't addressed anything yet. I think Ivan, you had a question?
Sure, thanks. I just have a question about the whole OPCW thing that's coming to light. And as it starts to drip out, and it sounds like there's more coming maybe, what do you think the response is going to be from like our traditional media? Are they going to address it? Are they going to spin it? Do we have a historical example of the internet age where this kind of thing has happened? Like, what do you think is going to happen? Is it your opinion?
Yeah. Well, what's interesting about the Dumochemical attack, you know, it's not like the weapons of mass destruction, where all the evidence came out long after the event. At this point, we're almost seeing it in real time. I mean, it's only 1 year since the event, and really it hadn't been fully resolved. And yet now we're seeing it collapsing altogether. But what we're seeing from the media, of course, one, we saw the death of James Missouri. And again, I don't believe there are any coincidences. I think potentially, I mean, it now appears that he was killed rather than committing suicide. It could be that he was financially benefiting from the sponsorship of the White Helmets. It could also be that everything was collapsing, that the Duma chemical narrative was collapsing, that his role in producing the evidence for a corrupted report would come out. It could be all manner of things, you know, but I don't think it's a big coincidence. As regards the media, what we're seeing at the moment is basically an attempt to defend and protect that narrative. We have an indication that Bellingcat, which is a blog that's funded by various NATO-aligned institutions, is about to try and put out a counter to the leaks. But I have an indication that there are more leaks to come, so this is going to become you know, a bit of an information war. And of course, what it will do is empower other people within the OPCW to come forward. And I think the only way that the OPCW can regain any credibility is to do as requested by the Syrian government and by Russia and by a number of other non-aligned countries, to hold a meeting and to allow all of the suppressed reports to be aired and discussed, and for there to be a revised final report. That is the only way, in my opinion, that they will regain any credibility. But whether the media will accept any accountability, very unlikely.
I can ask, could I be just ask you one last question?
Yeah.
It shouldn't be too difficult, but I think it's kind of interesting. There was a call to get for the White Helmets to get a Nobel Prize, a petition online. Well, you had a petition going with change.org, if I'm not mistaken. And could you tell us a little bit about what became of that petition?
I think this was the first nomination for the White Helmets in 2016. And there was a petition on change.org asking for signatures for them to receive the Nobel Peace Prize. So I thought, well, okay, I'm going to put out a counter petition on the same website, on change.org. Within 2 months, or I think it was 2 months, my petition had received more than 3,000 signatures, while the original petition requesting the Nobel Peace Prize for the White Helmets had only received around 1,000. Mine was being hit on almost on a daily basis by hundreds of people, and basically change.org took it down because they claimed it violated their community standards. Now, what's really interesting is when I looked into the billionaire network behind the White Helmets, change.org is a big part of that PR industry that is backing the White Helmets, so it's not really very surprising that they took it down. But yeah, that was you know, a relatively early example of the censorship that you get whenever you question this organization.
Well, with that, I think that you've given us a feast of information and lots to dwell on, and hopefully it'll help encourage some conversations for us going forward. So thank you so much, Vanessa, for your time and your patience, and maybe you could join me in giving a good round of applause.